Welcome to Anything But Ordinary with Spooky and Raven. Tonight our topic is Monsters of North America, the Piasa bird and the Florida skunk ape. Hello, I'm your host Spooky, along with your other most awesome host, Raven.
Hey, how are you tonight?
I'm doing good. Almost lost my train of thought there.
Well, we got so much on our brain with the holidays and stuff coming up, so
a lot of people
are on vacation and running around, so we weren't even sure if we were going to have a show or not tonight, but we decided to, right?
Yep, we sure did. Just to give you people a break from your Christmas shopping and thinking about Christmas.
Or baking,
or sending me a Christmas present, you know, all of that stuff.
You don't have no Christmas presents for you.
How's the weather out there?
Actually, it's not that bad for being where I live. It's supposed to be blizzard in and everything else, but we've only had rain, so.
That's the way it's been here. We've only had rain and it's cold.
Right.
Yeah. Well, tonight, one of our topics is about a legend, a North American monster legend in my neck of the neighborhood.
Right. Well, this topic, I'll just say real quick before we get totally into it. We're going to kind of do a variety of different shows about North American monsters, but we're just kind of picking two tonight, two different ones. But this show may be a recurring theme down the road with other said cryptids or creatures, you know?
Right, if people like this or...
I don't care.
If they don't like it, we're going to do it anyway.
Yeah, if we're interested in doing it, we'll do it. I'm just saying this is just part of one.
Well, we had three or four actually picked out for tonight, but the two that we're going to talk about are a little bit involved, and we didn't think we'd get the other ones in. Mm-hmm. And like I said, this first one is a legend that's in my area, and I have heard about it just about all my life. On the bluffs near Alton, Illinois, there's this huge painting of this prehistoric hideous bird referred to as the Piasa bird. And when I was a kid, I used to always look for that because I knew that we would soon be in Alton because it was actually kind of a long trip from where we lived. But the Piasa bird is a Native American dragon. And it's painted on the limestone bluffs now near in Madison County near Alton, Illinois. And it's
something you, like you said, you grew up listening to and hearing about.
Right. I don't know what's wrong with me tonight. For some reason, I seem to lose my train of thought. But it's said to have flown over the great father of the waters, which is the Mississippi River. Mm-hmm. Thousands of moons before the white man came to this area.
Mm-hmm.
Back when Magellans and Mastodon were still living. Mastodons, if I remember right, weren't they the mammoths?
Right, those big hairy elephant type creatures.
Well, Piasa means the bird that devours men or bird of the evil spirit.
Yeah, so that's like what you're saying. But before prehistoric time, you're saying this?
Right, we're talking prehistoric times.
Okay.
I mean, this was the painting was up on the bluff. When you back then, mm-hmm. Well, even back in the turn of the century, before this area was really developed, there were limestone bluffs for about 50 miles all the way from Calhoun County all the way down to Alton, Illinois,
mm-hmm.
right along the river. So, mm-hmm. I mean, this place is a lot of the buildings in this area are built from limestone mined out of these bluffs. The early drawings depict it as part bird, part reptile, part mammal, and part fish, and it's painted in three colors, of which each color has a specific meaning, like red. It's painted in red, black, and green. And like red means war and vengeance. Mm-hmm. The black means death and despair. And the green means hope and triumph over death. Now, back in prehistoric times, the ancient Native Americans didn't really have a written word like we do now. They painted pictures to tell their stories. Their stories were either verbal
Right.
by
Native
word of
Americans
mouth,
fed, yeah.
or they painted pictures. And this was the way that they communicated. So this
Or
bird
not
is,
communicated, but passed down stories,
yeah,
yeah.
passed down their stories, and even their history really
Right.
was done the same way.
Through storytelling and word of mouth passed down, and as well as paintings and
Well, back
carvings or
in
whatever, you're saying.
I think it was 1763 when explorers of the Mississippi River, Marquette and Joliet, they recorded this painting in their diaries. They recorded a description of an image of this creature painted on the limestone bluffs about 40 or 50 feet above the water. And Marquette had even made a drawing in his diary of this painting, but somewhere along the way their canoe overturned and the picture that he drew was lost.
But I got the one up that I could find. I found a newspaper clipping from, I don't know, 1900s, whatever, way back in Alton area, whatever. That kind of shows the cliffs and those two guys in the canoe coming up and seeing the creature painted on the cliff there. It's kind of a little hard to see. And then I found a drawing that says it, that's supposed to be sketched from Marquette's diary, you know? So.
Right, and the painting that's up there now, excuse me, the painting that's up there now isn't even really in the original colors,
Right.
and it's also based on iconographs and people who had actually seen it back in the 1800s, because this painting was destroyed by the Mississippi Lime Company when they were mining their limestone, because the painting was actually on premium grade limestone. Where it's at now, it's on a poor quality limestone and it doesn't really hold the painting very well, so yearly they have to restore this painting.
Right, but the painting, the reason why it's there is because there was this great huge bird that was
Right.
attacking the Native Americans in that area,
Right.
and that's why it's on there. I don't know if you happened to mention it at the beginning or not, but we're just talking about the painting right now. But they stumbled on this painting, and then they started to, what, talk with the natives in the area, and that's when they found out what it was
Well, they
about.
landed near the site where the painting was. Now, according to his to Marquette's diaries, they landed near the confluence of the Illinois and Mississippi rivers. Now, if that is true, then this painting's in the wrong area, because the Illinois and Mississippi confluence, and what that means is that means where that's where the rivers meet. These two rivers meet. Then that is to the west, about the other side of Grafton, Illinois, which is 20 to 25 miles to the west of Alton. So, in my opinion, I don't think this is the original location. And and there's also there at, because I grew up in that area, 25 miles to the west of Alton. And in that area, there's also a stone cross at the spot where Marquette and Joliet supposedly came ashore. But there used to be limestone bluffs all down that river. I mean, they were just followed the river on down. So, like I said, in my opinion, I don't think that it's painted in the original
Where it
location.
used to be. But you're just saying when you were as a kid, you'd always see this creature on this limestone when you guys were going to and fro
Well,
places,
when
and
we were
other
going,
people are seeing it, and then you get curiosity, well, hey, why is this thing
well,
here painted? And that's
the
when you
thing of
found out
it
the
is,
story
right,
of.
well, no, the thing of it is, ever since I was a kid, and some people even, on some of my internet friends even know this, I love dragons. And when I was a kid, this was a dragon. This is what I thought this painting was. I thought it was the painting of a dragon. And it just fascinated me. And so I started reading about the legend. I started digging into it and stuff, and it just it and besides that, I'm also interested in history, especially American history, and especially history in my hood.
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 I wasn't expecting you to say that. It's not something you normally say, but yeah. So you
But
basically saw this, got to interested, asked about it, and then you started digging into it, and that's when you found out the story of this said creature, which you're going to talk
right.
to us about right now, right?
Well, the
Because you were t
legend is
you were talking about a book or something that's been around since the 1800s.
it was a book by John Russell, and it's been around since 1836. And John Russell was a minor professor in a university at a university in Alton, Illinois. At one time, Alton, Illinois had quite a few universities and even a military academy. Alton, Illinois has quite a history of its own, and it's really fascinating to read about it. And it's also considered the most haunted little city in Illinois.
Right, we're going to
And
talk
it
about some of the
sits right
paranormal
across the
stuff.
river from St. Louis, Missouri.
Right, I mean, a different night we're going to talk about some of the paranormal things that happen in those, in your hood
In my
eventually
hood.
too, yeah, because there is some really good stuff that, you know, you've talked about over the years, but.
But the most enduring and fascinating legend about this bird was written by John Russell, like I said, in 1836, and I'm going to tell you the legend now. Okay, before the village of the Illini, the mighty river swept to the south, clear and fresh. The surrounding woods were rich with game. The bluffs and trees shielded the mighty Illini from the harsh winds that sometimes swept in from the north. Their village was a happy and secure place. Chief of the Illini was Watoga. He was old and had led his people in the ways of peace for most of his lifetime. Watoga and his people loved their home and way of life. One morning, as the sun began to climb toward the summit, which was about the summit of the sky, which was about noon, terror struck the village. A number of braves were leaving on a fishing expedition. Some were already in their canoes leaving. Some were preparing to leave when suddenly the very earth seemed to shudder from an alien scream.
An alien? Well, he's
An
really trying to be
alien scream.
descriptive in 1836, but yeah,
Right.
go ahead.
This is John Russell's story of the legend. Out of the western sky came a gigantic flying monster. Its body was much the size and shape of a horse. Long white fangs stabbed upward from its lower protruding jaw, and flames leaped from its nostrils. Two white deer-like horns angled wickedly from its head. Its huge wings pounded the air with such force the trees bent. Its stubby legs held dagger-like talons, and its spiked tail wound around its grotesque body three times. Almost before the braves realized the danger, the creature swooped across the beach and carried away one of the braves. From that moment on, the Illini were terrorized by this incredible and bloodthirsty monster that they now called the Piasa bird. Each morning and afternoon it came, shattering the peace of the village with its thunderous beat of wings and blood-chilling screams. More often than not, it returned to its lair with a victim. The Illini looked to their chief for a solution to this menace. Time and time again, he led them through famine, illness, and the threat of warlike tribes. But Watoga felt helpless before this new danger. The beast seemed indestructible. Its body was covered with scales that seemed impenetrable. The best efforts of the village arrow maker and the tribe's finest archers were to no avail. Watoga turned to the Great Spirit. For nearly a full moon, he prayed and fasted. Then, in a dream, he found the answer. The body of the Piasa bird was not protected under the wings. After Watoga offered thanks to the Great Spirit, he called the tribe together to devise a plan that could destroy the monster. All that day, the arrow maker sharpened arrow heads and painted them with poison while the tribe fasted and prayed. That night, Watoga and six of his finest braves crept to the top of the bluff. When dawn came, only Watoga was visible, standing straight and firm in full view while the braves were hidden behind nearby rocks and ledges with their bows ready. Suddenly the scream of the Piasa bird broke the silence and the monster swept into view. It sighted Watoga and went straight for him. Watoga fell to the ground and grabbed the strong roots that grew there, but the beast sank its talons into his flesh. As the beast raised its wings to fly off with its prize, the six braves came out and shot arrows into the beast in the area under its wings. Each time the bird raised its wings to fly off, six more arrows were shot into its body. Finally, the poison did its job. With one last agonizing scream, it released its hold on Watoga, fell into the great father of waters, and disappeared forever by the swift currents. Carefully and tenderly, the braves carried Watoga back to his teepee, where in time he recovered from his wounds and was nursed back to health. The Illini held a great celebration, and Terahai Anawaka, who happened to be the arrow maker, mixed paints and went to the bluff and painted the picture of the Piasa bird in tribute of Watoga and the tribe's victory. Every time an Indian passed the painting, he shot an arrow at it to salute the bravery of Watoga and deliverance from the monster.
Now that was John Russell's version.
That was John Russell's version, but I'm sure this legend has been embellished, exaggerated, and stretched to its limits.
Right.
But basically, the legend and the story remain intact.
But he wrote that in what would you say, 1836? So that's one of the first written down versions of the Native Americans' legend of this bird, this creature attacking not just one tribe, but several tribes in the area. And he was one of the first ones to have his book published, which you can tell he's a writer. He's kind of sensationalizing it up or whatever.
Right.
But that's what they did back then because they didn't have TV, radio, and what have you. But
that's true.
So, I mean, and also, you know, when you're telling...
And also he took the description of the bird from the painting. Now, let's get real. The bird did not look like that painting.
Right.
Okay.
The painting looks like a lion and a deer and a...
The painting tells a story because that's what the ancient Indians did. To tell their stories, they painted pictures, or it was by word of mouth. And each part of this painting tells a section of this story. And let's face it, they were not Rembrandts or Monets back then.
Some of them could have been. You don't know. We haven't seen all their work. We don't say that. But.
Well, that's true, too. But for their time, and this is an awesome painting. It really is. But like I said, let's get real. The bird did not look like this.
No.
This is the story and the depiction of the story that the arrow maker put up on the bluff. And each part of this bird was a certain color, and each color, like I said before, it was the original painting was red, green, and black, and the red part told the story of war and vengeance, and then the black part of this painting was telling the story of death and despair, and then the green part of the painting was telling their story of hope and triumph over death.
Right.
Fighting this monster bird. We don't know what this monster bird was. It could have been a pterodactyl. It could have been a condor. It could have been anything.
Yeah. But the way it's, you know, well, it's been painted several times over. Plus, you just said earlier in the show tonight that it's been moved from its original spot because the landowners at the time were blasting all the limestone to get at that stuff, and they didn't care about all of the
they
drawings
did nothing.
That were on
yeah.
there, because there was also other things on there besides that.
This
creature.
Painting, we know for a fact that the painting existed in 1673 when Marquette and Joliet went down the Mississippi River, because they did note it in their diaries. But
this is like 325 years ago.
Right, but some scientists believe that it had been up there since 1200 CE. And for those of you that don't know, that stands for Common Era, which is the equivalent to BC and AD. But
But they don't know. They didn't see it, so they don't know how long it was
they
up there.
Yeah, but they believe that that painting had been there that long. And then in the 1800s, this big business comes in, and this painting is on prime quality limestone, and they want that limestone, so they just blow it up. They mine this thing. They didn't even bother to try to save it or preserve it or anything. So the original painting was completely lost.
Well, right, and the painting here, I'll show the picture again of where they have it, is near these caves, and these caves are what they were trying to say is where this large bird resided in, supposedly.
Right.
Or that's what John Russell was saying.
John Russell, even, and like I said before, he embellished this story. He was a writer back in 1836. He was a writer. He was a minor professor at a university. I forgot what he taught. And so he embellished this story, and I personally think that he was looking for fame. He even claimed one time that he climbed the bluffs and found the cave of this creature, and that it was full of bones. But later on, he did admit when confronted that that was made up, that that was untrue.
Right. When you were talking about the python bird or whatever, I did a little research too and digging to see how far back I could really find with the internet or whatever. And there was a couple of telegraphs from Alton back in 1902 and stuff. And I found one where they were talking about there was another python bird on the face of a rock at the Hall's Bluff. And that was back in 1902 when I was reading the newspaper. And they were talking about how what they were explaining, what you just said, that the greed of commercialism and stuff destroyed one python bird in this one area that you were talking about. But they were talking about that this other guy, his name was George Dixon, him and a group of, you know, curious seekers or whatever, they, you know, went and spent a lot of time annually collecting relics and whatnot of things that they could find, you know, and, you know, try to find other things on stones up there in the bluffs and stuff like that.
Right.
And that's the body. I think they had like Kodaks with them, and they took like snapshots. This is what the paper is saying, and scores of the rock pictures of, you know, different strange creatures as well. Because they said that Alton and that one that we're looking at now wasn't the only area. There's other spots where they had.
There were definitely other spots, and I personally believe that they did fight some prehistoric bird. I have no doubts about it.
Oh, no, but I'm just talking about that there was other.
But when I was a kid,
scribbling on the walls.
When I was a kid, we used to go back up in those hills. We'd find arrowheads and stuff. There were people that found petroglyphs, which are images carved into the stone and painted over. So, and like I said, the ancient Indians did not have a written language. I mean, of sorts. But if you stop and think about it, their paintings were a written language for them.
Right. Well,
that's how they told their stories, was by mouth, or, you know, by word of mouth, or by painting pictures.
Right. And this guy was saying that the other thing that he had found, which I'm trying to finish up real quick, is that he found on the Hall's Bluff was a smaller version of the one that everybody's always accustomed to seeing, but he saw a smaller version, but its likeness was more of a huge bird than this dragoned creature. I mean, it's similar to it, but it was more designed as a bird. And like you said, the first sketchings of that bird were lost when that guy's canoe got tipped over or whatever, so people were kind of guesstimating, and it turned into this lizard creature, you know?
Right. I think the scales on the bird represent the fact that they could not penetrate it, or they could not kill it with their arrows until they painted them with poison. I don't know. I'm not an expert on it. Only an expert could probably interpret the story that this painting is telling. Of course, other ancient Indians of the time knew the story. You know, I mean, they could probably look at this and they could tell what the story was.
Well, like you said, that on that one, let me click back on that one photo of the sketching, whatever, that was Professor William McAdams. He was an Illinois state geologist. Ooh, can talk tonight for whatever reason. He was the one who created the illustration of that bird in the 1800s, and it was from his drawing that all the modern-day renditions of this bird are known to be. But even in his day, the original painting didn't exist. So,
well, yeah, it was gone by then. In 1940, and I cannot remember the name, and I remember reading this in the history, but in 1940, an amateur geologist and mountain climber was climbing the bluffs near Grafton, Illinois, because he had kind of studied this, and he had gone to Grafton to look for the cave. And he claimed that he did find a cave, and it contained what looked like human bones. So he collected about a dozen of them, and he took them to an anthropologist friend of his at the University of Chicago, at a university in Chicago. Anyway, the bones were determined to be Native American and quite old. But unfortunately, soon after, the man was killed in an automobile accident, so it taken the location of the cave to the grave with him. To this day, as far as anyone knows, this cave has not been found. But every once in a while, somebody shows up in the area going to climb those bluffs and look for the cave. This is an enduring legend. This is something that people still try to solve even to this day. And I think a lot of it has to do with this painting because, you know, people just, they want to know what this painting is, what this bird was. And it's like I said, I believe since it was prehistoric time, it was either something like a pterodactyl or a condor or maybe it was just some grotesque flying monster.
I don't
know.
Who
knows?
Well, I know.
It could have been a dragon. People that I've shown the picture to tell me, you know, like I said, when I was a kid, to me it looked like a dragon, but they tell me it looks more like a griffin.
Well, the word dragon is what is dinosaurs. The word dinosaur didn't come into play till late 1800 something. I can't remember the exact date right now at the top of my head. I'll probably remember after the show. But dinosaurs were really called dragons back in the day. It was switched later on in the 18 something, and then that's when the word dinosaurs came in. And then as time went on, people started thinking that dragons and dinosaurs were two different things, but they really weren't. But as far as when I was, you know, digging this up after you kind of brought it up and talked about these different creatures and things being seen in your area from, you know, they were talking about this bird, having all this paranormal stuff in your area to Bigfoots and stuff like that. And I started looking up, and I found another old telegraph thing where this guy was sharing his history with them so that they keep it written down for the town and whatever else like that. And his name was James R. Wilson, and he was born in about 1815, and he was a resident of Jersey County, Illinois. And it said that he lived there from between, I think, about 1818 to 1836 or whatever. And when he was about 13 years old, there was like only a couple other people around in that area where he was living who had some kids and whatever. And him and two of his other friends, his name were Joe and Sam. I'm going to put the links up so people can go read some of the sites and newspaper clippings that we were reading from too. They met an Indian family at the mouth of the Piasa Creek. And like you said, that's where it empties into the Mississippi River.
Right.
And they had made friends with these Indians, and they had a daughter who was about their age as well. And they learned the true legend of the Piasa bird from them. Now, James and his friends were about 13 or whatever, and the Indian chief told James that they had traveled down the Mississippi up to the Piasa in a large birch canoe and made camp where their village once stood. And he had put up his, wigwam,
teepee,
whatever, where his father stood, where his father's teepee used to be when he was a boy. And then he showed them on a little hill nearby, he showed them where the graves of his ancestors were, and, you know, he told them of wanting to be back at this place again before he passed on. Well, he had shared, the Indian chief shared a lot of stories with James and his friends, whatever, and one of them happened to be about the python bird. I think my cat's knocking. Can't help that. Cats are crazy. But anyway, the way that this Indian chief explained to him, he said this bird for a long time had destroyed children and even like teenagers, you know, in between, you know what I mean?
Right.
And he said that they were fighting this creature for a bird for like a long time, and it wasn't just attacking their tribe, it was attacking a lot of different tribes in the surrounding area, whatever. And he said after they had killed it is when somebody went up and painted the picture on the bluff on the rocks or whatever, on the Mississippi at or near the mouth of the Piasa. Now he said there was a cave in which it lived in, and James Wilson said he never saw this picture himself, but has often heard that it really existed. So he never really officially saw the painting, but he heard the story from this Native American family that they were growing up around. And the guy was about six. It says here in the notes it was about 1828, and the old chief was 67 years old, and he was born in about 1760. He said his father was probably about 1735, and his grandfather was about 1710, and his great grandfather was about 1680. And it was when his great-grandfather was a boy of 10 or 12 that they killed this great bird, and therefore it was around the 1600s time. You know what I mean? Mid-1600s. Right. And he was saying that, hold on, my notes here. He kind of heard it both from Native Americans in that area as well as white people in the area of this huge bird or whatever, but this, as you know, he was listening to him, this James Williams believed that this bird wasn't like a dinosaur or anything, but he thought it was more of like a condor, the way that they were explaining it, whatever. He said that this bird would, you know, go way up in the sky where it looked like this tiny little speck practically and do circles, whatever. And then when it saw its prey, it would come down at such a rapid descent and then just swoop up and kill these younger people and take off with them. And it was just snatching these Native Americans just like out of nowhere. And the way that they were describing it to him, he believed that it was probably this huge condor, you know, from talking to the Native Americans, from what he was believing to be
the way. Well, that kind of makes sense, because a condor, if it could carry off a human, it would seem to me that it would be either a small child or maybe
a young teen. Yeah.
But the story tells me that, which I suspected anyway, that there was more than one bird
in the
area.
You know,
there were others attacking other villages.
Right. Well, they were saying that he was going on with the story, whatever, they believed the reason why this bird was attacking them is because they thought it was a curse sent upon them because of some tribal wars that they had had earlier, you know. And so they tried to appease the Great Spirit, like you said in John Russell's story, but it didn't work. So then they started to fight the bird, and they, you know, attacked the bird many times, but it, you know, it seemed like it was wounded or whatever, but it never got killed. This is what they're saying. They said they had several attempts, but failed every time. And the warriors would end up with broken arms just by the stroke of this huge bird's wings, or their face or body would be badly damaged because of, you know, the bell of the bird, you know?
Right.
And this is what this Indian chief was telling these 13-year-olds at the time that was passed down. It was his great-grandfather was the one who participated in the battle of killing this bird as well. Well, like you said, in that John Russell thing, this Native chief said that they decided on another plan of attack, which according to his description was they were on top of this hill, and on one right hand of the road going from, what was that, Delhi? Or wasn't that the town I told you about?
Delhi
to Alton, and that they descended to the Python area. And so they kind of had the whole area.
Delhi, by the way, still exists.
And didn't you just say that they just discovered an unknown native village that was there?
Well, I don't want to interrupt your story, but yeah, they're putting in a new highway, and they're putting a bypass highway in to bypass Jerseyville, Illinois, And while they were digging, they discovered an ancient Indian village. So that
Kind
stopped
of matches what he's saying.
right, and it's in that area. It's in the, it's matter of fact, it's just down the hill a little ways from Delhi. I think Delhi was like a half a mile up the road from it. And the people that were living in the house there had lived there for 30, 40 years, didn't even know there was an ancient city underneath their ground.
Right, and this man's talking about, so it kind of backs up what you guys can go read. It's more of an in-depth journal, tells a heck of a lot more than just the python bird. But he, as they were talking, what they did is after crossing the creek, they dug this huge hole early in the morning that was several feet deep, and they covered it with branches and hazel bushes, and then they all kind of hid in different places. Oh, my cat is driving me nuts. Just ignore him. And what they did was they waited for the bird, and then they used his great grandfather as, you know, the
Bait.
bait to attract the bird to come out of the cave. And when he got the bird's attention, the bird started flying out of the cave, and that's when they all jumped it and started attacking or whatever. And, you know, it took them a good while to take down this bird, but they finally pinned it to the ground and, you know, chopped its head off. And it didn't go down in the water and disappear. They took it home and they took it apart, you know, all the
Right.
bones and everything else. And they used it to make charms or medicine bags out of it, and which he showed that James R. Williams, as when he was 13 years old, some of the parts of this bird and of the medicine bags and everything else that was made from it. And they basically had this huge feast for several days with all the neighboring villages joining in because they all lost their children as well. So it was like a big celebration for everybody and a big relief that they finally took down this ginormous bird. But in the way that they were describing it to this guy who was talking to this native chief, that it was more of like a huge ginormous bird that would be like a thunderbird or a condor type of thing, not
Right.
some lizard cow looking deer thing, you know?
Well, it's like I said, John Russell took his description of the bird from the painting and from the sketches made of this of the painting. So he embellished it and he made it out to be this huge, grotesque bird that was made up of different animals like deer and fish and reptiles and everything else, when, like I said before, this picture, we know that the bird that attacked the village did not look like this painting. This painting was the story that these ancient Indians were telling. And it just, you know, each part of this painting, this dragon or this bird on there told a different part of the story. And but some people just took it that, wow, this is what the bird looked like. No, it's not what the bird looked like.
Right. And you know, they took it down, like I said, with tomahawks and all that other stuff. But this guy, you know, and he was saying that's what this Indian chief had told him, and he was about 13. So he's saying, let's hear. A stranger may seem the incident, the tale, the tradition, or the story has been passed through by one person and through another to James. So, you know, everything's going to get exaggerated, like you said. And he said that the old chief's great grandfather lived to be upwards to about 90 before he died, which was like 1772. You know, so he lived a good long time to tell this story to many people, and he was a part of this attack.
Don't worry about Vinny.
Yeah, he just wants his 15 seconds of fame. He always does this every once in a while. Sorry about that. Cats can't do anything about them.
Well, another thing too is in that particular area, there was a Mississippian culture known as the Cahokia. It was a huge city called Cahokia, and it was inhabited by 20 to 30,000 residents, all Native Americans, and it was actually the largest prehistoric settlement or city north of Mexico, and they were a war tribe, a warlike tribe. So maybe because of all these wars that these
Native Americans.
ancient Indians declared on other tribes, maybe it was a curse, you know. I mean, they probably believed it was a curse, and this bird was sent to punish them for all the wars that they were declaring on other
Natives, tribes.
Native Americans.
Right. And it, you know what? It could have been. I mean, we don't really know, but the way that they were describing it and stuff, it seems like, I mean, because there's different stories told, but this guy was talking about from 1700s and on, you know, and he shared this story with people so that they could keep the history of it going. He didn't make money and stuff at like John Russell did off of a
Yeah.
book back in 18, what was it,
Right.
36, whatever he said. But he was saying the way that this chief explained the bird, whatever, he said that the body was probably about as big as a pony, and that it was about 25 feet from tip to tip of the wings, and when standing erect, he said it was about 7 to 8 feet high. And condors back in the day, they got really huge.
Yes, they did. And they were plentiful back then. So it could have been a condor. It, like I said, you know, I mean, we're talking about prehistoric times on these legends.
And they're
And who
predators.
knows how long, you know, I mean, it could have even been a pterodactyl. It could have been a
That's
condor.
true.
We will re never really know
Unless
for
we see it.
sure. What this bird was, what this flying monster was. But
Weren't we when we were looking up? I swear we just talked about this last night. I told you about that thing that the cops had seen. What was it, 1977 or 76 in Texas? Somebody saw. They or a couple of people swear they saw a pterodactyl.
right, and that was on the Navajo Indian Reservation too, that it was seen. And in over St. Louis and Alton, Illinois, and on up a little bit further north in the 1970s, there was a huge monster bird sighted then, and it had tried to carry off a small child. And I think it was Glendale, Illinois, is where it was. I'm not sure about the name of that town, but this was back in the 1970s.
Right. And it's not, I mean, it's not just here of this one native tribe talking about fighting off this ginormous monstrous bird, but there's other tribes and other throughout centuries of
Right.
people talking about ginormous birds of being around or attacking
Oh
them
yeah,
or
it
stealing
wasn't just
livestock and
exactly. It wasn't
kids and
just this
stuff.
area. It's just that we're talking about this area because this is an area where I was born and grew up in.
Right, and it caught
This
your
is this
attention.
this is a local legend that I had heard about all my life.
Right. Except for the painting, like you said, it seems to have changed throughout the years to have
Yeah.
with coloring and whatnot, because you were talking about certain colors being on the wall or whatever.
It's not even through the years as they've restored this and relocated it, because it's been relocated that I know of 3 or 4 times. And each time it changes a little bit, but it's not painted in the original colors. I think it's kind of a goldish color now with white in it and other, you know, subtle little colors. But the original painting was
Red,
red,
black, and
black, and
green.
green.
Right, like you
And
said.
the reason that we know that is because, like I said, Father Jacques Marquette recorded this in his diary, as so did Joliet.
But they seem to have lost the original sketching of it, and then this other dude sketched up from what his thought of what he believed what they were seeing,
Right. Well,
but nobody truly knows what the original thing looked like. So,
Marquette drew a sketch of the painting that he saw, but like I said, later on, their canoe tipped over, and the painting, while he was able to save his diary, he was not able to save the sketch of the painting. So, and I didn't read anywhere if Joliet drew one or not, but most of the original history that we know about this painting is what Marquette and Joliet wrote in their diaries. And then later on, a few years later, another guy, I can't even remember his name, come down the Mississippi River, and he saw the painting also, and he recorded his description of the painting. But for some reason, Marquette was the only one that actually made a sketch of the painting he was looking at. I don't know why the other guys didn't do it. You would think that since they saw this painting. But the second guy did say that there were gashes kind of in the painting, and it was worn a bit because of the habit of other Native Americans. When they would go by the painting, they would shoot their arrows at them.
Right, in
At
honor
it.
of the all
But
the
that
that
was
died.
right. But what these people didn't realize is that this was the same as saluting the chief and the braves of this village for their battle and for killing this monster.
Yeah. So, basically, this is just a story that you've heard about your whole life.
Right. And it's a painting that I've seen all my life. When I first saw the painting, it was higher up on the bluff. It wasn't down low like it is now. I mean, it was higher up on the bluff. But like I said, the original painting, I believe, was destroyed in somewhere between 1850 and 18.
Stream here. We should be on here. Sorry about that. We lost complete internet, not just to my computer, but to everything there. So I apologize to those who are listening, but we are back. And spooky. Hopefully you're back.
I am back, and we apologize for that.
We have, weird rainstorms and stuff. It's
I
been
know we've been
kicking
having
us
them
off.
here too, and we do apologize to our listeners for the interruption.
Hopefully it won't be kicked off again. So if we do, just hang around. We'll hopefully get it back as quick as we can. So I apologize for that stupid storm, net issues. So.
But like we were saying before, there had to have been more than one of these birds.
Right.
There, and the only known record of the original paintings were from Marquette and Joliet.
Right.
And like I was saying before we were cut off, when I was a kid, this painting was higher up on the bluff. It wasn't down low like it is now. It was way up there. And I used to, and when my parents and I would go to Alton, it was such a boring ride. And I knew when I saw this painting that we were almost there. And it was, it was kind of a relief to get where we were going. I didn't like going to Alton anyway. And it's been relocated several times, and every year it's on such the limestone that it's on now is so poor quality it won't hold the paint. So every year they have to go and restore this thing.
Right.
Where the original painting was, it was such high premium high quality limestone that somewhere between 1850 and 1860, the Mississippi Lime Company just had to have this limestone, just had to have it. So they destroyed the original painting, didn't try to preserve it, didn't try to save it. But I don't think back then that they were as keen on preserving things as we try to be now.
Well, when I was researching the stuff and I was reading back through all the telegraph of Alton and surrounding counties when they did have some type of newspaper thing from back in the 1800s, 1900s, or whatever, this wasn't the only bizarre thing that they were talking about, the strange bird, but they were also talking about, and I mentioned a couple of them, and I'll put the links up in our YouTube description so you guys can go and see some of the things that me and Spooky had kind of read about. I mean, she already knew about this because she grew up about it with it, but. That they, like you said, discovered a lot of these bones and stuff, but in there as well, they discovered giant bones, not just regular size
Right.
man and female bones and little kid bones or whatever, but they found to be bones of people that were like 8 feet, 9 feet, 10 feet
Right.
tall, you know? And it makes me think of another thing that's
Well,
brought up in your
that's
area
another
about
show that we're going,
giants
yeah,
as
that's another
well,
show that
so.
we hope to be doing soon is about giant people that actually lived.
Throughout, it's not just here, but they found it throughout almost every
Right.
state. There's huge skeletons and everything like that. But I thought when I was looking into this, and then all of a sudden I see that mentioned as well as with Bigfoots and everything else, and I'm like, this is a very interesting area.
It is very
throughout
interesting
history,
area.
You know, not through history, but throughout the centuries or whatever.
And it does have quite a history. Just a couple years ago on one of the islands, they found bones, human bones, and actually they found a full skeleton. And they thought that somebody was murdered and their body dumped on one of those islands. Well, come to find out, after they studied the bones and everything, that the bones dated back to just before the Civil War. And digging deeper, they found out that the island that these bones were found on is what is referred to as Smallpox Island. They had a Confederate prison down there, and as the prisoners came down with smallpox, they sent him over on this island in the middle of the Mississippi River to die. Hmm. The Mississippi River has such a current that it's impossible in places to swim it.
Right.
And what was amazing to me about the story was that every single year in the spring, we get bad floods. And so we got a body that they estimated was over 150 years old, and in that 150 years had never washed to the surface before because of those floods.
Well, that's an interesting story in itself. I mean, it's not about the North American monsters that we're talking about, because you picked these
interesting. But it's a little bit into the history that surrounds this area, because this area is very rich in history.
Right. But I thought it was very bizarre, because here I'm trying to just study about this huge bird that you've always kind of talked about, so I could kind of read back and see how far back it really goes. Is there any other people talking about it as well besides this one dude who just wrote a book? Because, I mean, come on, writers write stuff, and since,
right.
You know, they hype it all up just so they can sell more of the
And John
the
Rusk
book.
Definitely hyped up his story. I mean,
you could tell the difference, but...
There is actually no denying that. He hyped up his story.
But it's definitely out there, because there's several people back in the 1800s and the 1900s and the 1700s that they were been talking about this, not just the Native Americans, but also European white folks, whatever.
Right.
We're talking about this as well, and I was going back and reading articles and seeing a lot of things people talking about it, and the main theme is that there was a large bird attacking several people and not in just one area. So it had a huge, you know, hunting ground. And I think that it probably realized that these people were easy pickings for it. You know,
exactly.
It was soft, easy to tear through and stuff. And
it was,
you know,
easier for this bird to swoop into one of the villages and grab off a small child or whatever.
Yeah, it's sad.
Than to fly around in because there's a lot of wilderness in the area,
right.
Than to fly around through those thick trees, you know, trying to find a deer or something. Yeah, that makes sense to me.
But that wasn't the only creature that I found out when I was digging up for the Native Americans' legends and histories. It talked a lot about Ape Man, you know, and Hairy Man, which is two topics you picked tonight, was the skunk ape and the python bird, because she picked both the topics tonight for North American Monsters, which is a bunch of them all over people are talking about, so we're going to do a variety of different
stories. You would be
it, but...
surprised when I was digging into North American Monsters.
Yeah.
What I found, I mean, there's just a variety out there, and it was actually kind of hard to pick the topics for tonight, and I thought, well, you know what, this one's in my area, let's talk about it. And it was a little bit hard picking the second one, because there were so many other good ones to choose from.
Well, you picked both, so I was, you know, cool with it, because I thought it was fascinating. But the fact that there's papers and several people's telling this story, and it wasn't just one man talking to one tribe, but it was people talking to several different Native Americans in the area and their tribes, and they all kind of come up with the same thing, saying, yes, this did happen. And then supposedly, you know, not just that one guy found a bunch of bones, but later on when people are still exploring, because they did find a bunch of...
And even today they talk about it, and even today there are people that try to climb those bluffs looking for the cave that this bird lived in. They do it even today.
But that's, and I think there's, some of them, the people are on History Channel right now, it's one of them, they're giant hunters, whatever, they've even been down in that area as well, and had mentioned about the huge bird as well during their history right. show or whatever. So I do find it interesting. I do believe that that there was a ginormous bird that was attacking people. Was it a dragon that had the body of a you know, lizard, a head of a deer and a lion, and it had four, you know, claws, feet? No. I think it was a huge bird, like you said, and the way that they depicted it was to try to show how tough the body was, how fierce it was, like a cat or a certain animal would be. You know what I mean?
Right.
And the reason why it had certain coloring is, like you said, it described in their story of passing along to other natives, and people who were passing by would know, hey, this is in the area and this is what kind of happened, you know?
Right. And I do believe that something happened. And this wasn't the only area. I mean, you know, these giant birds were all over the country.
Yeah. People are still seeing some weird oddities to this day. They call them
exactly today.
Yeah.
Exactly.
And that's a different show, the Thunderbird topic. But this is more about the Python legend that you had in your area and, you know, how people...
I know. I keep calling it Piasa, and it's actually pronounced Piasa.
Oh, sorry. I'm just going off of how
no,
you're
it's
saying
not,
it.
No, it's not just you. I've been doing it, too.
You should know it. You're in that area.
I know. I
Shame
should know
on
it,
you.
But it is actually pronounced Piasa.
Right.
And but I do believe that something took place in the area, and I believe that this painting tells the story of it.
Yeah, but it's not depicting the actual...
It's not the actual bird.
I
don't believe
like,
that.
Yeah.
I just believe it's the story of it.
Right.
That they're trying to... While they are trying to give a description of the bird and how tough it was, you know, and how difficult it was to kill, I do believe that this painting is a story. It's not... The bird that attacked them, it's just the story of the bird that
right, but
that
I could see
them.
It being like a condor from South America or whatever coming up in that area as well. Or it could have been, like you said, a pterodactyl, because there are dinosaurs / dragons being said to be still being around today, even in Africa and other places, you know?
Right.
So, I mean, it was a possibility. It is a possibility that it could have been a prehistoric type bird. But more than likely, I'm thinking it was one of those ginormous...
The reason that I always thought that it was a pterodactyl was because...
Of the scales.
Of the scales and things, you know, to show how tough it was and the skin and all. That was my interpretation of this painting, is that it probably was a pterodactyl because this painting has been up since prehistoric times. So, but condors did live during that time.
Right. Well, even from that one Native American chief's story to the James R. Williams, when him and his friends, when they were 13, the way he described it from having the size of like a big pony's body.
Yeah.
It being
and see, and that's
8 feet
yeah,
high.
And
the wingspan
and that's
alone
too.
Matches a condor.
Yeah.
So.
And that's the thing too, that the Native Americans pass their stories down. And their stories don't change. You and I could start a story, and we could tell 10 different people, and by the time that 10th person gets it, that story's changed. Native Americans don't do that. Their stories never change.
Uh-uh. Because they have great pride in passing down their history.
Exactly.
But
And a lot of it is passed down by word of mouth.
Right. Well, this guy would be like 67, and... His great-grandfather was 90 when he died, so that means that the chief was about 13, 14, you know, between 12 to 15 when his great-grandfather, who had experienced this bird, told him the story repetitively. Then he was about 67 when he met James R. Williams and his two friends, Joe and Sam, and they were about 13, 14 when they were told the story. So it's not like... They couldn't comprehend what they were hearing,
and
they would
and
remember
they,
it.
And
you know,
they
this
lived.
Is something pretty...
Yeah,
and the
great-grandfather, the great-great-grandfather lived during a time when it was possible that there were all kinds of giant birds flying around.
Yeah, in the 1700s, yeah. You know. But, yeah, why don't we take a quick break so I can kind of fix my computer stuff or whatever and check on it, make sure everything is being okay. So we're going to take, like, a quick 3-minute break. We're sorry we got cut off a little bit there. But when we come back, we're going to talk about the skunk ape in Florida, another topic that Spooky kind of picked, which is kind of interesting because I guess a lot of people from the 50s all the way up today are still seeing some type of bizarre monkey creature running around. So
yeah.
We'll be back in 3 minutes, and thank you for sticking around. Welcome back to Anything But Ordinary. I'm your host, Raven, and hopefully here's your other awesomeness host ever, Spooky.
Yeah, I'm back.
Wasn't sure. We had the little problem before, so hopefully...
I want to apologize to everybody for our little snafu and our little technical difficulty. Her and I are both having storms. Not good weather, so And I don't know about where she lives, but where I live, it's out in the boonies, so yeah. I'm lucky I'm still on the air.
Well, it's holidays and everything else, so, you know, everything's a little chaotic. Who knows? Maybe everybody's on the internet, too, so that can happen if you have too many people on in the internet in the same area. It could slow down people or crash them as well. So hopefully we won't have any issues for the rest of the last hour, but here another topic we're going to talk about tonight was the skunk ape. It was kind of like, I forgot why, but it came up in some kind of conversation that we had had about something. I don't remember if you saw something on cable or whatever, and you thought, and it kind of came up, and we thought, oh, we'll just throw this one in as well, you know?
Well, when I was looking up monsters in North America, to be honest with you, it's one of the first ones on the list.
Right.
And I did see a program about 4 or 5 months ago about it, and I found it interesting, and
I know it's scattered all over YouTube where people are showing photos and videos of this unknown thing, but basically, you know, the skunk ape is also known as the stink ape and, you know, Florida's Bigfoot, and it's, you know, basically a hominid cryptid said to inhabit Florida, North Carolina, Arkansas, and, you know, other nearby areas there. And the old timers in that often referred it to as like a swamp monkey. Now, you know, these skunk ape encounters have been reported, like I said before we went on break, have been reported back as far as the 60s. I'm saying reported where people have written down police stuff, everything like. But the sightings of these creatures and similar looking type creatures have been talked about for centuries across the country.
Now, the skunk ape should not be confused with Bigfoot.
Right. It's supposed to be like two different things. But I think from when we're going to be discussing this tonight and kind of talking about different things, I think people are seeing two different things down in North Carolina, Florida, and Arkansas as well. And I think they're kind of mixing them up. But the skunk ape is said to be like this large, hairy, bipedal mammal that weighs in the excess of about, you know, 450 pounds and a little bit up. And some say it stands, you know, from 6 to 12 feet tall. Now, it's kind of huge.
12 feet, that's
big. Well, but, you know, people's perception can be off a little bit, you know.
Well, when you're scared, your perception is definitely off.
Right. But, you know, the skunk ape encounters, I mean, people have described it, this creature to have, like, this nasty odor. And they say that the stench is similar to, like, you know, rotten cabbage or rotten eggs or methane or, you know, kind of like a skunky smell, you know.
Right.
And it's not just, like, a slight scent. I mean, it's really awful. So it's, like, extremely putrid and strong enough that it discourages anybody from kind of getting too close. Or even if you don't see it, you'll definitely smell it before you see it. So it alarms people right away. Hey, you know, what the heck? And that's kind of like why they say this ape got its name. That's why it's called the skunk ape, because of the awful stench that it gives off. Now, many people have these different theories too. That's if this thing really exists, is that when the creature is upset, it gives off like this musk to deter close encounters from unwanted visitors. They also say the foul smell is contributed to its diet and where it lives, you know, and they say it, like, it hides in alligator dens filled with, you know, swamp gas and rotting animal cadavers and stuff like that. But I mean, like me and you know, anyone who resides near nature knows that all wildlife has their own distinctive scent, you know.
Right.
Even humans do, if they're not bathed in perfume and all the other stuff. We all have our own scents and smells, you know, depending on our diet, too.
Well, there's one guy, too. He's actually a professional skeptical investigator, His name is Jack Nickel, and he claims that the sightings are black bear.
Right.
And it's likely that this is sightings and that the sightings are misidentification of wildlife or even a hoax. But there's just too many sightings to dismiss it.
Right. Oh, sorry, I laughed a little bit because Scooby was saying putrid. Are they using Axe body spray? That cologne is god awful.
That stinks. Oh my
god. I don't understand why guys wear that. It's the stupid commercials. And not just that. I know people who like buy several of them and they'll mix the two different scents and spray it on themselves. And then it's like they're bathed in it. And they come over and they're like, how do you like my new cologne? I'm like, ugh, you know?
Yeah. Oh, fine. Now go home and take a bath.
Yeah, 50 baths. Yes. Yeah,
I know. I personally, if a guy walked up to me and had Axe on him, I would walk away. I don't like the smell of it at all.
Axe him to leave.
I will Axe him to leave.
Yeah. But it says that these apes are like, you know, omnivores, and that their diets basically consist of both meats and plants. And, well, we know Florida, I mean, they have definitely a lot of fish, reptiles, deer, you know.
And wild hog.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And being in the summertime all up into fallish time, of course they're going to have the wild plants and berries and stuff that they could dine in as too. So I can see, you know, it being a prime area for any animal to want to reside in. I mean, there's water, there's meat and vegetation and good hiding.
And we're talking Florida. We're talking about a tropical environment, you know. I think it's interesting that according to the United States National Park Service, a skunk ape doesn't exist. It doesn't exist at all. They just deny it. And if the Florida skunk ape is like the Yeti or the Sasquatch that evolved from Gigantopithecus, then yeah, the Florida skunk ape is, I'm keep saying ache. The Florida skunk ape is a bipedal ape.
Yeah, it's possible. For sure. Yeah, if you go by what you just stated, yeah.
Well, I think one thing is, okay, back in the 1940s, they used to film the movies Tarzan. The Tarzan movies were filmed in Florida. And, of course, they had all these monkeys and all these apes, you know, different kinds of apes, chimpanzees, orangutans, you know, all of these. And for years, they used these monkeys in these Tarzan movies. Well, in the middle 1950s, I believe it was, they moved the filming from Florida to Hollywood movie sets. And they just literally turn these monkeys loose. That's why there are monkeys in Florida today. And I believe, my personal belief is that these skunk apes do exist. And I believe that they are from these monkeys that were all turned loose back in the 50s. Because the Florida climate is ideal for them to thrive.
Weren't there like hurricanes and things that happened too that damaged certain like facilities that had apes or orangutans or monkeys or whatever, and they ended up being escaping too? I think that
I don't know about that,
like that
but I know that they say that is why there are pythons in Florida, because when a hurricane hit, this breeder down there, he was set up, his building was more like a tent than it was a regular building, and all of the snakes that he had were gone. But down in around Miami, Florida, they have special people that deal with just monkeys, because the monkeys will go into neighborhoods and, well, actually they live in the neighborhoods, but people feed them and they become a nuisance down there in some parts of Miami and Dade, Florida. So they have
sort of like raccoons, you know?
Yeah, they have. Yeah. But they have these special the special department of the Humane Society and the wildlife animals, where they go in and capture these monkeys, these nuisance monkeys. What they do with them, they never tell.
Probably lab and science stuff. Hopefully not.
But a monkey will live, especially like a chimpanzee or an orangutan. they live 25, 30, 35, 40 years.
Right. But the crazy thing is, people have been reported seeing skunk apes and other bipedal creatures, because I think they're seeing two different type of species is what I'm, are different. I don't think they're just seeing apes. I think they're seeing possibly Bigfoots as well from all these stories and reports that we've been reading, because you can go online and see tons and tons of people sharing their encounters from, you know, from the 50s all the way up to today's date. And it's right. Not just that, but there's people who had been talking about seeing hairy creatures even before that, long before
there
that.
Actually seem to be more sightings of this skunk ape, or just as many sightings of this skunk ape as there are a Bigfoot.
Yeah.
And the thing of it is, even police officers are seeing this thing.
Right. And the weird thing is, like, we're going to kind of name off some of the reports here in a little bit or whatever, ranging from, you know, the 70s up to a little bit today. We're not going to go through all of them. Like I said, we'll list the links where you guys can go and check it out. But when we went down to this one site, what was it, the BFRO site or whatever?
Yeah.
And they had where people were coming to report their stuff. And it shows the different counties and then the different states. And it'll show you how many there are. And if you just look at Florida alone, my gosh, there's like hundreds and hundreds and hundreds
right.
and hundreds and hundreds of reports.
They're more commonly, even though that they have been spotted in North Carolina and Arkansas.
Florida seems like the main
conception. Florida is
where
the
they
most
live.
Common place for the sightings.
Wait.
And but some of those reports on the BFRO, some of them are Bigfoot sightings.
Yeah, there are.
If you go to the cryptozoologist website, I think it's cryptozoologist.com,
mm-hmm.
They have quite a listing of
people telling their experiences.
People
of apes.
Telling their experiences of skunk apes.
Right, and I think over time, an animal can adapt to its environment and learn to survive and thrive. And then if it starts to reproduce, then these animals, their offspring are going to be a little bit better off, and then their offspring's going to be better off, and they're just going to adapt and continue to grow and thrive in that environment. And like we said, there's plenty of food from vegetation to meat all year round, and it never gets too cold, you know, so it'd be okay for
especially down in the Everglades where a lot of the sightings take place. You know, you're down there where it's practically summer all year long.
Right.
Your biggest threat down there are hurricanes.
Right. Now, somebody said, what's the difference, or not somebody, Scooby12, one of our viewers, awesome viewers, had mentioned, what's the difference between skunk apes and Bigfoot? And some people will say there is no difference between skunk ape and Bigfoot. Some believe that they're actually the same type of creature, where other ones, I think people are actually seeing large primates. That, like you said, may have been set loose. I think are seeing Bigfoots.
The people that are seeing these skunk apes, that's like if you look at the picture that's on the screen now on the right, that is
orangutan or something.
Obviously an orangutan.
Right. And we're going to mention that photo and how it came to be in a little bit.
And these things do walk like apes, where a Bigfoot seems to
walk more humanish. Yeah.
But these skunk apes are obvious apes.
Right, and they act like more primate.
Right, they look like apes, they act like apes, they smell like apes.
I don't know what ape smells like. I haven't been to the zoo, whatever.
I've been to the zoo, they do not smell good.
Well, I haven't been to the zoo for a while, but I'm just saying, even the zoo, they probably taken care of better, but The people who are reporting the skunk apes and the primate type of creatures that they're experiencing, they're explaining it having the behavior of, you know, that said monkey or creature or whatever. But the people who are seeing Bigfoot are saying that they swore it was almost human or was a human.
In my opinion, when they're spotting something that's over 6 feet, now this is just my opinion, and it's walking erect, then I think you're getting more into Bigfoot. Apes don't really get that big. I don't care how much they have adapted or where in the wild they're living. They always have those ape characteristics.
Right. Well, in the 1970, one of the early reports I saw, I wasn't going to go way back, but I know there are some way back already into the 30s and the 40s I saw just tonight or whatever. But there was one guy, they were a fisherman from Placid, Florida, near the Gulf of Mexico, and he was like a shrimp boat, him and a shrimp boat crew tells of seeing, like, they called it yetis swimming as much as 20 miles out in the Gulf. But the way they kind of explained it, it kind of looked more like an ape. But the captain said he had seen one swimming underwater and also diving. Now, I found that interesting because a lot of people for a long time and scientists were saying that monkeys and apes and primates, they can't swim and they can't dive. But that is known to not be true because even just recently, there's been two biologists reporting in the American Journal of Physical Anthropology.
But you're talking about apes though that are living in the swamp. The swamp is water. The swamps, I mean, while there are pieces of land in the swamps are 80-90% water. They had to adapt, and I believe that they do adapt, and I do believe that they do swim.
Right. Well, what I was going to say is in this American Journal of the Physical Anthropology is the August issue in 2013. It says, they say, these two biologists said that they have documented, you know, and videotaped primates and apes swimming and diving behavior. And that you know, this whole time, there was other scientists saying, oh, no, they don't know how to swim or dive and whatever. Just because they haven't experienced it or seen it doesn't mean that they don't. Well, there's people out here in Florida saying that they're seeing these ape-type creatures swimming and diving underwater.
Right.
And I thought, okay, well, this whole time I've been taught that they can't. So when I went to start to research and found out that there are biologists and people reporting from the past few years or whatever that the apes do and can swim and dive. So, okay, that kind of backs it up, what he may have
and
seen,
some,
a swimming
and
monkey.
And some apes in the wild, not skunk apes, but like over in Africa or other place that naturally have these apes. They have been seen going into the water, not swimming, but going into the water waist deep to try to catch fish. So it's
almost
just like you don't see it.
Yeah, it doesn't mean it doesn't happen, but almost any animal has the natural instinct to swim, you know. And if these creatures had lived here in Florida for a while, like I said, then they learn to adapt. And when they learn
right.
how to do certain things, then their offspring are automatically going to be doing it naturally.
They can't, and so on.
So,
in my opinion, they cannot survive in the swamp as long as they have and not adapt enough to swim, because there's not that much land in the swamp. I mean, there is land down there, but it's mostly water.
Right. But like I said,
sooner or later, they're going to be in that water.
Right. But from these reports that we're reading, there's definitely two different types of species type things that people are seeing from, sorry about my chair, it's crackly, but, you know, from apes to Bigfoots, you know, so.
Right. Well, in 1973, Terrence Craig Smith of Nobleton, Florida, in July of 73, he says that he and his father, at dusk, were in a four-wheel drive truck, and they thought they saw a man fishing, so they approached him. And what they came upon was a creature that was 7 to 8 feet tall, and when it raised up, it had hairy arms and legs. Its chest was bare, and it had a huge muscular chest and shoulders. He said that it ran towards them, then jumped over their truck and went into the swamp. Now, Immokalee police did a cast of the print of the footprints they found, and they were five-toed and they were 15 inches long. And another was seen at a horse ranch in January on January 9th, 1974 at night, and they said it ripped the head off a pony and jumped in a fence and ran.
After it got caught, or, you know,
after
startled
it got caught,
or whatever.
But that's one of the few reports of any violence associated with these things. Because normally the people who are reporting these things do not report anything about them becoming violent.
There are some, but most of them are just brief encounters and the thing takes off. But there are some where
right.
they're not really attacking the humans, they're attacking livestock. But this one that you just said in 1973, the way you kind of described it, made me think of a really huge ape, you know? The description of it and how it leaped and jumped over the truck. That'd kind of be like how a big gorilla would, you know, take off to get away, you know?
And, well, they jump through trees and stuff, so it just seems possible to me that they would be able to jump over a truck.
Well, I know, but the way that he's describing whatever, it made me think of it. It was like fleeing that way. He didn't say that it was running on two legs. It was like, da-da-da-da. He was describing it like how a huge gorilla would kind of get out of the area.
Right.
And to me, the description of how huge and muscular the chest and the shoulders and the arms are, you know, to me that sounds like a huge gorilla, you know. So
right.
That one to me sounds like it would be a gorilla one. But then there's other ones, you know, and I think it was... maybe in this one of the newspaper reports I have here, I might have cut that one out, but in April 18th of 1974, this was in the Palm Beach Post, it said that there were 7 youngsters reported seeing what looked like a skunk ape in a wooded area on Ranch House Road near their houses. Now, they said they saw it first on Tuesday, then again on Wednesday, and this little kid said, "I may be a little kid, but I know what I saw," said 9-year-old Lori Holmes. And Lori and the 6 other youngsters all described the animal they saw as between 6 to 7 feet tall, with dark matted hair, long arms, sharp teeth, and 4 toes. It's pretty close for them to see the toes. Anyway, it could be a man just dressed up in a suit.
Yeah, really, I wouldn't get that close.
I know. But they said it could be a man dressed up in a suit, but I don't think it was, said Tommy Streeter, and he was 10. He said, "I saw him running on his hind legs with his arms curled out, and when he turned around, I saw a white streak on his back." The 2 boys, Tommy Streeter and Mike Edwards, reported seeing the skunk ape on Tuesday from a distance of about maybe 100 yards. He said, "We were walking down the path and we saw something black and hairy in the bushes. He made something deep, it made like a deep scratchy sound from the throat, and he said we got scared and started running." That's what Mike Edwards said. The 2 also reported seeing the skunk ape reach out the window of an abandoned shack located next to the path in the woods they sometimes take on the way to Meadowood Park Elementary School. "He had bare skin on his knuckles, and he just reached out the window," Mike said. Mike's mother, June Edwards, said she might have overreacted when the children came home and reported seeing the ape. "But if something's wrong in the area where our kids go back and forth to school, then I don't think it hurts to check it out," she said. She called the sheriff's department about the incident, and Mrs. Rita Carr, whose son Scott also reported seeing the ape, was inclined not to believe the children's stories. So another mother was like, "Eh, whatever. These kids have heard about the skunk ape, and they have very vivid imaginations. It shows how kids will go through mass hysteria just like grown-ups." This is one mom, which I would hate to have her as my mom. You know, if I saw something, she's like, "Ah, it's all up in your head."
And, well, really?
Yeah, thanks a lot, you know. But it says the Florida skunk ape, so named because many of those who claim to have seen him says he smells like a skunk and has the right white stripe, and had been sighted off and on throughout South Florida since 1970s. And the most recent prior incident involving the skunk ape took place on January 9th when a man named Richard Smith reported hitting an ape-like creature with his car on U.S. 27 west of Hollywood. Now, this was in the Palm Beach Post on April 18th of 1974, and these kids were all seeing something from what it sounds like to me, another ape. You know, not a Bigfoot, but an ape, when they were describing how it had the matted hair and how it kind of had its arms curved in and down.
Well, if you've ever seen an orangutan walk,
arms do curl.
They hold their arms out and they do curl.
Right. And then some of them do have a streak on their back. And their knuckles are a little bit not as hairy as the rest of their arms and stuff. So the description
And an ape does have a bare chest.
Right.
So they've never reported a Bigfoot having a bare chest that I know of, that I can remember. But an ape does have a bare chest.
Unless
a chimpanzee does.
Yeah, Bigfoot might shave. We never know for...
I'm not sure
mating processes.
If they have a bare chest or not, but I know chimpanzees do.
Yeah, have thinner hair and whatnot on there. So I thought it was kind of interesting in the way that they were describing it to me. And, you know, there's another site. What was that one site? That crypto site that you were talking about. That has a bunch of these newspaper clippings, so you guys can go...
The Cryptozoologist.
Yeah, it's either that one or the BFRO one that has all these different... newspaper clippings that you can go back and read from time and experiences of what people were talking about. And it wasn't just like once a year. I mean, some of them were several in 1 year.
Yeah. Well, July 25th of 1997 in Marion County, Florida, a family at Half Moon Lake were camping near, I will get this out in a moment, people. Please bear with me. A family was at Half Moon Lake camping area in Ocala National Forest when they had an encounter. And their story is, my family and I were hiking on a nature walk in the forest. When we walked across a small bridge over a stream, we stopped to rest, and I allowed my two sons to go explore. A few minutes later, they returned panicking and told me there was a gorilla, so I went to go check it out. When we got there, they led us. There was a Bigfoot kneeling next to the stream drinking. It noticed us standing there and ran off into the forest. Now, the environment at the time was a small spring-fed stream with a sandy bottom, and there were also two large oak trees on the north bank of the stream. I don't know what that has to do with it.
Well, they were just trying to explain the area, because this is one of the reports at the BFR sites, you know, and the people who are reporting it to these people, they'll ask them questions or whatever, saying, well, what's the environment like? What time of day was it? What month was it? And, you know, tell us everything
that
you can remember.
Well, I'm kind of wondering about that, too, because there really are not that many Bigfoot sightings in Florida.
But the thing is, the kids called it a gorilla, but the dad called it a Bigfoot. So, you know, maybe the dad just assumed it was a Bigfoot, but maybe the kids saw more detail, and to them it maybe was really more of a gorilla type thing in Florida that they were seeing in this park camp area. I thought it was kind of funny that they called it a gorilla, but the dad called it a Bigfoot. I'm assuming that it might have been more of a gorilla.
Well, in...
Because 9/10 of the time, the first thing you say it is usually what it is. Not that, you know, because when the dad's going back reporting it, he probably have got to thinking, well, maybe it's more of a Bigfoot. But I don't know. He didn't really say how it ran off either. He just said it took off running off into the forest.
Well, one of the more famous sightings in Florida was in 2000.
No, 2001, actually. I looked it up all the
way. 2001. The Sarasota County Sheriff's Office received an anonymous letter in January of 2001. And the page contained a long description of a strange encounter with a 7-foot creature. Now, this was sent in by an anonymous woman. She never gave her name. She just sent the letter and two photographs. And the anonymous report included two photographs of what appeared to be a giant orangutan with long flowing fur, a gray patch of hair around the creature's lower jaw, which was full of fearsome looking teeth, and two eyes blazed in the camera's flash. The woman wrote that on three different nights, an ape had entered her backyard to take apples left on her back porch. She was convinced the ape was an escaped orangutan. The sheriff's office keeps a digital copy of the photos, the letter, and the report for the curious, but did not conduct an investigation.
Yeah, didn't she say that it had like an awful smell that lasted well after it had left her yard, too?
She wrote...
Do you have the letter that you, did you write down? I mean, I have the photo of the report and the letter up, but I didn't happen to write it down to say it.
I have the photo.
Oh.
If you give me just a moment.
Sure.
But
this wasn't just a one occurrence. She said that this thing continued to show up at her house basically the whole week.
Right.
And she,
I mean,
it was
three different occasions. Occasions.
Right.
Okay, this is the letter that she wrote. Dear sir or madam, enclosed, please find some pictures I took in late September or early October of 2000. My husband says he thinks it is an orangutan. Is someone missing an orangutan? It is hard to judge from the photo how big this orangutan really is. It is in a crouching position in the middle of standing up from where it was sitting. Wow. It froze as soon as the flash went off. I didn't see it as I took the first picture because it was so dark. As soon as the flash went off for the second time, it stood up and started to move. Then I heard the orangutan walk off into the bushes. From where I was standing, I judge it as being about 6.5 to 7 feet tall in a kneeling position. As soon as I realized how close it was, I got back to the house.
Right.
It had an awful smell that lasted well after it had left my yard. The orangutan was making deep whoomp noises. It sounded much farther away than it turned out to be. If I had known it was as close to the hedgerow as it was, I wouldn't have walked up as close as I did. I'm a senior citizen, and if this animal had come out of the hedgerow after me, there wasn't a thing I could have done about it.
Right. And this photo here on the right is one of the photos that she had submitted to
right.
the police station, whatever. And the photo that I showed right before this was
it's
the
also
police report.
Yeah, and it's also considered an official photograph of a swamp ape. Let's see.
And then, like you were saying, that Laura, you were going to talk about, because you had mentioned to
well,
me about...
I'm not done with the letter.
Oh, sorry. I apologize, people. I'm spooky.
Oh, no, that's okay. Let's see, it says, I was about 10 foot away from it when it stood up. I'm concerned because my grandchildren like to come down and explore in my backyard. An animal this big could hurt someone seriously. For 2 nights prior, it had been taking apples that my daughter brought down from up north off our back porch. These pictures were taken on the third night it had raided my apples. It only came back one more night after that and took some apples that my husband had left out in order to get a better look at it. We left out 4 apples. I cut 2 of them in half. The orangutan only took the whole apples. We didn't see it take them. We waited up, but eventually had to go to bed. We got a dog back there now, and as far as we can tell, the orangutan hasn't come back. Please find out where this animal came from and who it belongs to. It shouldn't be loose like this. Someone will get hurt. I called a friend that used to work with animal control back up north, and he told me to call the police. I don't want any fuss or people with guns traipsing around behind our house. We live near I-75, and I'm afraid this orangutan could cause a serious accident if someone hit it. I once hit a deer that wasn't even a quarter the size of this animal and totaled my car. At the very least, this animal belongs in a place like Busch Gardens where it can be looked at properly. Why haven't people been told that an animal this size is loose? How are people to know how dangerous this could be? If I had known an animal like this was loose, I wouldn't have approached it. I saw on the news that monkeys that get loose can carry hepatitis and are very dangerous. Please look after this situation. I don't want my backyard to turn into someone else's circus. God bless. I prefer to remain anonymous.
Right. And then I got the photo of the police report written up and then the letter that, you know, a copy of the letter that she had sent. And you guys can, you know, find that on the internet as well.
Well, it's obvious that this woman thought it was an escaped pet.
But in that photo here on the right, the big one, all of a sudden I got a weird accent. It shows one of the photos that she had taken and sent in, and it does look like a orangutan, but other people believe it to be Bigfoot, you know. But she got a bigger, closer look at it. I mean, she was right there, you know.
And she was like within 10 feet of this thing when she took this picture.
Right.
And it's very, very obvious that this is a monkey or an ape.
Orangutan.
And it looks exactly like an orangutan. It looks nothing like a description of a Bigfoot to me.
Right.
And it's considered one of the most, it's considered the official
yeah.
photo of a skunk ape.
Yep. And then other people, Bigfoot enthusiasts say, oh, it's Bigfoot, but it's not. I believe it's the skunk ape. That's why there's a difference. But like you said, the sheriff's office still keeps a digital copy of the photos and letter and the report. So if anybody's curious, they can contact and ask them at the Sarasota.
Well, Lauren Coleman is primary researcher on the photographs, and he helped track down the 2 photographs to an Eckerd photo lab at the intersection of Fruitville and Tuttle Roads in Sarasota, Florida.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I'm sure that they probably have the name of this woman by now, but of course she wants to remain anonymous, so they're not going to release her name.
I don't blame her.
And according to another researcher on the photographs, a Chester Moore Jr., the anonymous photographs were taken in Sarasota County near the Mayaca River.
Right, so they took these photos, traced them, and they figured exactly where it was. and help verify these photos weren't fake and everything else. So.
And then 12 years later, in March of 2013, that ain't 12 years, but anyway, Mike Falconer and his teenage son Justin were taking their usual shortcut through Myakka River State Park to meet Falconer's girlfriend at a Sarasota restaurant, and when they saw several cars that had pulled over just west of the Myakka River.
Well, it is if this woman saw it in 2001. The reports and everything says 2001, so 2013.
Or 2001, okay. Well, I was thinking 2011. Excuse me, you're right.
No problem.
Thank you. But they saw several cars that had pulled over just west of the Myakka River. South of Upper Myakka Lake, where a group of people were staring at something in a field, and Falconer said that he looked to his left and expected to see some white-tailed deer or maybe a wild turkey, and what he saw made him pull over and jump out of his truck. He said that he saw this big, dark, large thing, and it was walking. It was a charcoal-colored mass plowing through the dry brush about 400 yards away. He said that he also took a video of it with his iPhone S4, I think it was. But he said that, which he says is why the video is so tiny, but he says you can just see a speck. And when they ran toward it, they got about 80 to 100 yards closer to it and switched to a camera and zoomed in.
To snap photos? Yeah.
Yeah.
Instead of video. I would have kept it on video.
He said the iPhone video is hard to see, mainly because the camera phone was unable to zoom in on the subject while recording. What you can see is a mahogany-colored blob moving across the screen and deer frantically diving into the bush. Now, I...
away from it.
And the video is over 2 minutes long, and I've seen the video.
Mm-hmm.
And...
I have too, and to be honest with you...
I really doubt that it's an ape.
It seemed like more of like it would be more of the Bigfoot type of thing because of the
exactly.
way.
Exactly.
If
I don't
it
think it's
if
an
this
ape.
Thing
it's
existed,
walking,
yeah.
Right. It's what I could see. It's walking too erect.
Right.
And it's not running. It looks like it's casually strolling. And
but
that's
with huge
and that's
strides,
Bigfoot.
Though.
Yeah. And that's Bigfoot.
Right.
A Bigfoot characteristic.
And they do tend to say for the Bigfoot stuff. That these Bigfoot enthusiast people and whatever say that they tend to see it more after and near deer because I guess they feed on deer or whatever. But like I said, when we were looking through all these different reports, and there's hundreds and billions of them. I mean, not billions, but just so many. So we're not going to read them all off, but we kind of jumped from a little, you know, from the 70s, the 90s to up to today or whatever.
Well,
but this one guy that the video I saw too, and at first, I didn't know what he was looking at, but he panned over and showed all the other people that were, you know, had these better cameras and everything else. And I would like those people to come forward and share their stuff on the internet.
Well,
you know, contact someone and let us see what they got. Because this one lady had this amazing, expensive camera that had like a huge zoom on it, you know?
Well, that video is one reason. I'm sorry. That video is one reason why the U.S. National Park Service denies the existence of the skunk ape, because they say that there has not been any clear and substantial evidence, and that most of the evidence is coming from eyewitnesses who are unreliable sources. So in other words, everybody who has seen or encountered one is a liar.
Yeah, but didn't you encounter a big cat in your farmyard? Next to your building, and then you called the DNR, and they said...
And they told me that they did not exist.
But you were so close, you could have spit on it, you know?
I was 10, 15 feet.
Right. And the only reason why...
I walked around the corner of my house, and there it was going to the bathroom in my yard.
And that's the only reason why you kind of got
you know
away,
what?
Because it was in the midst
my
of going
phone call
to the
DNR over that could be another show. But they were trying to convince me. They said there are no cougars in Illinois. I said, well, I know a 300-pound cat when I see one. They said, well, see there, ma'am, they don't get 300 pounds. I said, when you're 10 feet from it, that cat's 300 pounds.
Right. But the point is, it was right in front of your face, and it was close, and you
right.
saw it. But they are just taught and told, you say this, and that's it, and there's no period these things can't exist. They can't be here because we've been told from word of mouth and from books that they just no longer exist here. But that's not true. There's animals in there not in their natural habitat in several different areas because people are bringing in wildlife.
Well, they
and
tell us
exotic animals, and then they can't take care of them. They set them free into the woods,
exactly,
into the wilderness, and into Florida.
Exactly.
And there are these monkeys and whatnot running around. And I don't know what Bigfoot is, but obviously there's a lot of people experiencing and seeing these things. Even you have experienced one in your area. So, you know, now with the technology that we have nowadays, you think that somebody somewhere has something that's a bit clearer photo, you know, because I saw this video, and yeah, it's hard to zoom up on a iPhone.
You can't tell me
that
photo on the right is not clear.
No, yeah, that ape. Oh, yeah. But I meant this video that we just saw of Faulkner's or whatever. You guys can go see it on YouTube. It was in March of 2013. His name was Mike, Faulkner or whatever. And he had, he has this video. But, okay, even with your iPhone or your Android phones, whatever, when you're zooming out, if this thing is, like, pretty far away, you still are, it's going to get more and more pixelated with your cell phone.
Well, 400 yards is not just a hop and a skip. You know, 400 yards is quite a distance.
Maybe it is for me. Maybe I can skip that far.
Not me.
Two skips. But this guy, you know, he wasn't alone. There were several people, and he pans over with his video and shows all these different people with their phones out. But this one lady had, like, I don't know, maybe a Canon or some really expensive camera that had an extended lens on it. So she had to have gotten a better shot of whatever this thing was. And there's people on the BFRO site and other sites are asking, if you know these people, please, you know, let us know or contact them and ask them if they can share the photos of what they got. Because if anything, this woman should have gotten a really better picture than what these people got on their phone. And that's, I want to see what she got, if this thing is what they think it is, a Bigfoot or a monkey.
Scooby says the national park people should just explain away a skunk ape as a guy in a costume wearing Axe body spray.
Yeah, because that stuff stinks. Please, men, stop buying that stuff and stop believing commercials that say if you wear this, you're going to have all these loose women all over you, you know, because it's not happening. Women aren't attracted to stinky cologne, okay? We're attracted to men that have a personality and, you know.
Personally, I like my men clean.
But in 2012, you know, they had another report up in the Everglades, west of Broward County, and it was like daytime, you know, and clear and sunny, and this guy, his story was this: he was out in the Everglades target shooting alone because he said he had pulled off the road to target practice with his new gun, and he'd only been in this spot for like a few minutes, enough time to kind of like set up bottles and cans, you know, and he said he basically shot through one clip of ammo, and as he was reloading his second clip is when he heard something making like a lot of noise behind him. Now, he said when he turned around, he saw a 6.5 foot tall, bipedal ape-like man thing looking and standing behind a tree staring at him from about 20 feet away. Now, he described this thing to have, like, dark brown hair with a face between a man and an ape-type shape. He said the arms were longer than a man, and he was positive that it wasn't a bear standing on two legs. He said as soon as he saw this animal, it let out, like, a deep grunt that the witness said he felt as well as heard. Now, the witness said he kind of glared it down for a few seconds, and then he started running off. He said that it basically scared the blank out of him, and as he got into his car, this thing was kind of running between trees a few feet away from him, and then he just said he sped off. No, so he was saying that he basically saw...
Well, I wouldn't have stood near that long.
I'm sure it wasn't as long as you think it is, you know. It was, you know, because when you see something, you look over and you're like, am I really seeing what I'm seeing?
I know. The moment may seem like it lasts forever when it only lasts maybe a few seconds.
Right. But this guy, in the way he's saying, it's about 6 feet, 6 foot tall or whatever. But I don't know, maybe orangutans and gorillas and stuff, they can get fairly tall. I'm not quite sure how tall they get or whatever. But the way he was describing this thing too, it had, you know, longer arms like a monkey or an ape would have. And he described that the face was more apish more than man. And he said he knows it wasn't a bear, but it was kind of standing behind a tree and it was grunting. Well, bigger apes and gorillas and stuff, they make that grunt sound at you, saying, like, you know, trying to scare you off or, you know, show that they're bigger than you type of thing. You know, but he took off and it was only 20 feet away. So,
right.
I mean, 20 feet away, you definitely can tell a man, a bear, and a monkey apart, you know? So I think that this guy probably did see a skunk ape, you know?
I'm sure he saw something as close as he was to it. He saw something and he looked it right in the eye.
Even,
So he saw something.
and it had to have freaked him up because he had a gun. He had a pistol with him, but
I know
even,
he had a gun, didn't even think to shoot it.
which is probably the best thing because you don't want to shoot an animal and then leave it half wounded for it to go hurt somebody else or hurt it, you know, and for it to suffer or whatever. But it
Well,
had to have
that's
been
true
pretty
too, but
huge and startle to startle you,
yeah.
and of massive muscle, you know. So.
But I'm not, but I mean, he didn't necessarily have to shoot it, you know, but maybe try to scare it off or something, you know, shooting
But not sometimes
at the ground or something.
it could have
But the
charged
thing
them
of it
too.
was, the man was scared. He was 20 feet away. He looked the thing right in the eye.
Right, and
So
this
he
was just
saw
2 years
something.
ago.
Yeah.
But I mean, even in the 70s, like in 77, you know, with all the thousands of sightings that they had said, we're talking about in Florida. I mean, the state legislation in April of 77 introduced a bill which was called HB 1664, and it was to protect this elusive, you know, man ape, which in part stated any persons taking, possessing, harming, or molesting any anthropod or,
Anthropoid.
thank you, or humanoid animal which is native to Florida, popularly known as the skunk ape, or doing any act reasonably capable of harming or molesting such animals. And the state representative was Paul Knuckles or whatever, NUCK.
Knuckles.
Yeah, I'm just spelling out for people.
I know.
OLLS wanted to make it a misdemeanor to capture or harass a skunk ape. And he basically hated to see someone catch one and put it in a circus or a zoo. So he wanted to kind of put this bill in to protect it if it ever came to be where people were capturing it or finally did see it. But that bill never did pass into law in 77, but that hasn't stopped the discussion or people continually trying to get a law passed to protect
Well,
this species if it is an unknown creature, you know?
wasn't there a law passed out west somewhere where it was illegal to harm or molest or capture or shoot a Bigfoot?
I think so, but I can't remember
I can't remember what
what
state it
exact state
was.
it was, whatever. But I definitely think with all the different reports that people are reporting on several sites, but the main one that people seem to keep up and keep going is the BFRO site. And there's reports all the way back from the 30s all the way up to 2014, and it's not just in Florida. They have them throughout the whole United States and into Canada as well. But a lot of the ones in Florida, it's like split down the middle, where people are seeing a bunch of skunk apes, which are like different
Well,
monkeys, orangutan, and stuff like that. And
I
then some people are
personally
seeing
think that
Bigfoots.
it is possible,
For an ape to survive there? Oh,
well,
yeah.
because Florida would be the ideal environment and climate for apes to thrive. And not only that, the Everglades are made up of millions of acres. I think it's 1.2 million, something like that. And so it would be possible for them to live undetected.
Right.
I just think that it's absolutely possible. There's probably, because there have been, recently, there have been more and more sightings of troops of apes. And what a troop is a group of apes. Okay, for people who don't know, I'm sure a lot of people know that. So there have been more and more sightings instead of just the lone ape, have been anywhere from 5 to 9 in a group. So there, and they, the, and one guy said that he knew that there were at least 7 to 9 in the Everglades alone. Now, I personally believe there's more.
Right. Well, see, to me, this doesn't seem like a legend. There's so many reports, and it's been consistent throughout the years, from the 30s and all the way up. There's several police officers as well, firemen,
Right.
who have experienced
And
this.
these police officers are seeing footprints and making cast of them.
Right, and now that we have a lot more digital stuff, I mean, people are capturing these photos, and the photos that they're capturing and what we're seeing, they do look it. It looks like a chimpanzee, and one looks like a my brain
And
just
the
went
thing of
dull.
it is too that more and more
Orangutan.
there are sightings near close to large cities, and in one instance one was seen reportedly running across I-75 in broad daylight.
Right, and then there's thousands of these reports, But it's weird because as we were going through them, just in Florida, we were trying to stay away from all the other different states because I think they're more of Bigfoot stuff or whatever. But I think people are seeing both these, you know, primates as well as some odd Bigfoot type of creature because it's just, there's two, you can definitely tell the differences in the stories when they're telling them. One's definitely like a Bigfoot and the other one you can clearly tell that they're monkeys
some type of right.
Creature.
Some people believe that the skunk ape and the Bigfoot are of the same species.
I don't
but
think so.
I personally think
they're
I personally think they are completely separate.
Right.
Because like I said, back in the 1950s when they moved these stopped filming Tarzan in Florida and moved him to Hollywood, they literally turned these monkeys and apes loose.
Yeah, but I don't think it's just them. I also think that there's a lot of sellers who sell exotic pets and everything else, and they're
well,
turning.
Some of them are.
When they get busted, or right before they get busted, they turn these things loose. There's drug dealers and other people who wanted to have exotic pets, so they order and they buy these things, and they turn out that they can't take care of them. They become dangerous, so they go and dump them off and leave them off in the wilderness, thinking
that
it's going to be okay, and then they go out and.
They
you know,
do that with those exotic snakes. When the snakes get big, get
well,
to a certain
snakes,
size,
but,
they
yeah.
start getting afraid of them and they turn them loose. Chimpanzees, for example. Okay, that woman in Massachusetts that had one that was like 20-something years old. The older they get, the meaner they get. And it's reported that they have the strength of, that one has the strength of 20 men.
Right.
And that thing ended up ripping a woman's face off. And the woman that owned it really didn't realize just how mean her ape was getting.
Because she was just choosing not to see it, but it was, you know. But
right.
That's the point. There's the point.
But what would she have done if that thing would have turned on her? It would have killed her is what it would have done. And they ended up taking this chimpanzee away from her, and I think they destroyed it. But when they're young, you know, for about the first 4 or 5 years, you know, they're like kids. But once they reach 5 years old and they start getting older, they get meaner because they say that this wild instinct just kicks in.
So do normal children. No, but...
Yeah, really. I've released mine back into the wild, but they found their way home.
Flee back to the woods. No, but I definitely believe that people are seeing these primates and... You know, they've capturing photos. They're all kind of describing these larger apes, gorillas, and everything else, chimpanzees and stuff. And I think that Florida's a perfect place for them to thrive. They got meat, they got vegetation, and it doesn't snow, it doesn't get too terribly cold. And animals can and do adapt to their environment. And I think over time they learn to swim, and then they taught the other apes, monkeys, and primates to swim too, whatever else. And then I think there's other people who are seeing something totally different. You know, and that's a different show. That's like a Bigfoot show. So
now,
I don't think the skunk ape really is a legend. I think that there are primates that are thriving in the Florida Everglades, and people are having encounters.
There
with
are
them,
monkeys
so.
Living in Miami and Dade, Florida. Why
in my
is
backyard.
It? And that is a fact. Why is it so impossible to believe that there are apes living in the swamps?
Because then that means the DNR and all these people have to do extra work. So, I don't know. Maybe you want to let people... We're running out of time, so... I just want to say thanks, everybody, for
I want to thank our mods tonight for doing a good job, and I want to thank everybody that came in to listen. We will not be here next week because Raven will be out of town. So, we want to wish you all a very Merry Christmas and join us when we return on January 6, 2015.
Right.
Thank you for coming, and please share us on Facebook or any other social media you happen to be a member of. And good night, everyone, and thank you, Raven, for a good show.
Yep, thanks, Spooky, and thanks, everybody, for coming. Have safe holidays. Don't drink and drive, and we'll see you next year.
And Merry Christmas, everybody.
And Happy Holidays. And we'll see you guys
Happy
next year.
Happy New Year.